In Siman Taf Lamed, Shabbat lifnei haPesach, the Shabbat prior to Passover, Korim Oto Shabbat Agadol. We call it the Great Shabbat. Why? Lifnei haNes sheNa'asah bo, because of the miracle that was done on that happened on that Shabbat. Lichora, we have to understand. Shulchan Aruch is a halacha book. It's not a musar book. It's not a rabbi giving classes. It's not a story book. Shulchan Aruch tells you laws, what you have to do, what you don't have to do. If the Shulchan Aruch on rare occasions deviates from the law and gives you some sort of what seems to be story, then at that point there has to be a reason why. And we have to know how does this apply to us, and what's the halachic element that it was important enough for the Shulchan Aruch to bring it down that this Shabbat is called Shabbat HaGadol because of the great miracle that happened on it. Rabbeinu Yonah writes in Sha'ar Teshuva in Gimel Yud Zayin that he says that the memory to remember the chesed, the kindness of HaKadosh Baruch Hu, is a mitzvat aseh, is a mitzvat d'oraita. Sheneemar, we learn it from a pasuk, this is Rabbeinu Yonah from the Rishonim. V'zachata et kol haderech asher holichecha Hashem Elokecha b'amidbar. You should remember the way, the journey that HaKadosh Baruch Hu took you in the desert and how He protected Am Yisrael and gave them whatever they needed. So remembering Chasdei HaBoreh comes out of Rabbeinu Yonah, to remember the kindness that HaKadosh Baruch Hu has for us is a kiyum of a mitzvah deoraita. A person does a regular mitzvah deoraita and there's no end to it, because every second of the day you can constantly be doing this. It's a great mitzvah to have in your arsenal. I got on WhatsApp today, maybe you got it too, somebody sent it to me. I hope the quote is true from the source, but the line is great anyway. They claim it's from the previous Boston Rebbe, that one year she told her husband's students before Purim that she wants to wish them two wishes. That their Purim shouldn't become so happy that it becomes no longer kosher, and that their Pesach shouldn't be so kosher that it becomes no longer happy. That's a very deep line. Let's try it again. Their Purim shouldn't become so happy that it becomes no longer kosher, and their Pesach shouldn't become so kosher that it becomes no longer happy. So I'll tell you where we're going with this tonight. I want to openly address a battle that most people have of all ages, definitely of the 15 to 35 age range, and most people are embarrassed to address it openly or to say it openly. That's a few words. I hate Pesach. That's the way it is. And then you ask them why. Because it's a pain in the neck. There's nothing to eat. My mother makes me crazy. There's nothing to do. There's this, so many holidays. This year you're going to gain at least 10 pounds with all the meals. The matzah doesn't sit well with me. I can't digest it. I have stomach aches the whole holiday. Not for me. Doesn't sit well with me. Most people would be scared to say it in that many words. But after Baruch Hashem, 18 years of dealing with people in the many, many tens of thousands, and hearing so many people's life stories and catching people in a moment of truth when they are willing to say what they really feel, I've heard this along the ream of this commentary hundreds of times for sure, probably thousands. And if this is the case, then we're making Pesach so kosher that it's no longer happy. And we have to understand what's going wrong. And one of the times that a lot of people, especially the younger teens, dread most is the Seder. When a kid is very, very young, I remember when I was in, let's say, second or third grade, so we used to come back after Pesach, and one of the cool things to discuss was how late your Seder ended. So if you ended at 3 a.m., that was like really cool. But then by the time we got to seventh or eighth grade, we used to come to school, and the cool thing to discuss was how early your Seder ended. If you ended by like 10:30 at night, that was like amazing. And if this is the discussion from kids at such a young age already, that means that the child is battling this issue at a young age. So we have to analyze this. What does this really mean? What's going on over here? Why is it like that? Pesach is called Chag Chirut. We spoke about freedom last week. It should be the nicest time of the year. It should be the happiest time of the year for each and every individual. So maybe something in our attitude needs to be fine-tuned or adjusted in order to do it right. The Pele Yoetz writes in the subtitle Dibur, speaking, when he talks about speaking, he says that it's a great mitzvah on the night of the Pesach, and every day, twice a day in Kriyat Shema, we do it, to be talk about Yitziat Mitzrayim. Comes to Pele Yoetz and says these words, Lav Dafka Yitziat Mitzrayim. It's not only a mitzvah to talk about the miracles of Egypt. Ela kol chasdei Hashem v'niflaotav. All of God's kindness and His great miracles. Asher asah, that He's done. L'chlalut Yisrael, for the general population of Am Yisrael, ben lipratav, or to the individual. Ben le'atzmo, whether those miracles happen for himself, ben le'acherim, or whether they happen for others. And he ends off this quote, and listen to these words, Hamsaper b'hem, somebody who talks about them, mitzvah ka'avid, is doing a mitzvah. That means, really what the Pele Yoetz is saying, something good happened to you, share it. When you share something good that happened to you, you're doing a mitzvah, because you're acknowledging that God did it for you, and you're talking about the chesed of Hashem. And just through talking about the chesed of Hashem, a person gets to great spiritual levels. By the way, there is a, I don't even call it a segula, because I think there's a psychological element to it, but it's funny, Magdashim write it as a segula, that if one is accustomed every day to take some time to share with somebody who's dear to him, or even a stranger, it doesn't really make a difference, the good things that he has in his life, then his life, the quality of his life will always get better. He won't have any downfalls, it will always grow. On one hand, Bukhayan Jews wouldn't like this gula. They'd say, ay nara, why would I say that? But ask all your friends that are in diamonds, the ones that weren't arrested this week. And the ones that, yeah, I say things openly as they are. You do a crime, that's it. But ask the your friends that are in diamonds. Right now the diamond district is not doing so well. It's struggling very greatly. And jewelry as a whole is not doing well. When the economy in general is booming, on paper at least, stock market's way up there, real estate's through the sky, so money is there. And this industry got hit so bad. And the weirdest thing is that in 2007/8, this industry was the last industry to get hit, and it got hit a drop. Manishtana, what is this? Then, they were the last ones, and suddenly now, the first ones, and in the worst way. And I'll tell you why. This is my opinion. I don't have a source for this. But everybody's entitled to opinion. That's the beauty of America. Freedom of thought. I never in my life spoke to guys in the Diamond District. And I know I might be generalizing. But in my life, I never experienced it. And asked a guy, has business? And he said, amazing. They always said, slow. No season. Season wasn't as expected. Sales are down. Times are tough. Never had a guy tell me, amazing, unreal. When prices was 5 times higher than today, and when prices are 5 times lower like they are today, same thing, same complaints, over and over again. And they meant well, they did it for superstitious reasons, not to show off, not that vainara, not the. But God said, you want to complain, you want to say your industry is not good, I'll show you what it means to have an industry that's not good. Talk about my chesed Hashem. There's no greater chesed Hashem than the diamond district. That an idiot would go pay tens of thousands of dollars for a rock? That's insane. The Rambam on that writes, Ilulei amishtagim, if not for the insane people, lo haya olam mitkayem, the world wouldn't work because all trade wouldn't exist. People wouldn't do these things. That's the greatest miracle of all times, this industry. And Dafka in the miracle, in the industry, it's based on the greatest miracle over there. We slap God and say, slow, it's not good, it's this, it's that, it's the other. God says, okay. Midah keneged midah. Get a taste of what you asked for. In other industries, they didn't do that. Just the opposite. In real estate, one of the ways brokers make money is they flaunt their sales. Right? They always list sold, 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 sold. Even though a lot of them are not even sold, but sold anyway. Even though maybe there's something a little arrogant to that, what do you have to show the whole world how many things you sold? But at the same time, there's something beautiful to that. It's Jews acknowledging, yeah, Hashem gave us the Yata Dishmaya. And we're successful in industries, and we do well, much better than others.
And God comes and says, all right, every so often there are natural crashes that are the system of the world, the way of the world. But in general, Jews do very, very well in this industry. The first thing of Shabbat HaGadol that a person has to take away from this Shabbat is to be a person who's a Gadol. And Adam Gadol is based on the way he expresses his life story. If a person's always complaining about his life, so then that's what he's holding. That's how small he is. And if a person's always thinking how great his life is, even when it's not, this is one of the times that's good to be in denial sometimes, then suddenly life becomes so great. Everybody, if I had to bet, every last person in this room knows this story. But the message is so powerful that maybe this should be one of the stories that we reiterate to ourselves every single day. The Chachamim teach us, Gemara, Masechet Brachot, other places, that a person's obligated to bless on the bad the same way he's obligated to bless on the good. Today we differentiate a bit. When one passes away, his krovim, meaning his children, for example, if a father passes away, make a blessing called Dayan Ha'emet, the God that's the judge of truth. But really, that's not the way it should be. The way the world really should be, this is a different blessing that we make for other reasons. When a person buys a new house, if a person's a wine drinker and understands what he's drinking, not convinced himself, and he was home drinking a wine of a certain quality, and then they brought from outside a wine that he wasn't aware was coming, of a much higher quality, you don't make a gift, you know, besides that gifin issue, whether you have to make a new gifin or not, there's a separate blessing that has to be made now. Hatov v'ametiv. That Hashem gave you a chesed, he brought you a more expensive wine, now you're going to enjoy it. Make a blessing, hatov v'ametiv. Today most people don't make it because they don't know the halachot so well, when yes to make it, when not to make it, it's a bit complicated. But there is such a concept. Others make a new clothes, hatov v'ametiv or shechianu, depending. You have to know if you do or you don't, but there is such opinions in certain areas. Kelim chadashim in Shulchan Aruch, it's discussed about. It could be if you buy a new car, not if the bank owns it. If you actually paid for it in full, and you own it, you might have to make atova amiti. That might definitely be a kli chadash. I'm not saying halakha l'maaseh, I'm just telling you opinions. There are opinions of each thing. That's the, everybody understand. I have something new, nice, I built a beautiful home. No, atova amiti, makes sense. But in Chazal it says that really, when a person dies, we should also make atova amitiv. And part of this exists until today. Today when a person dies, his son makes two blessings. Dayana emet by the funeral, for the death of the father, and atova amitiv a few days later for the inheritance that he got. That's not a joke, that's true, api halacha, that's the way it's done. If he got a real inheritance, yeah, without a fight with his brothers and then a peaceful one. That seems like the biggest absurd paradox in the world. What's the answer? Kol man da'avid rachmanan l'tav avid. Everything HaKadosh Baruch Hu does is for the good. That you don't see the good in it, the problem's by you. The problem's not by what's there. Somebody wrote a beautiful, beautiful song, but he wrote it in Chinese. You don't read Chinese. Does that make the song not beautiful? No, the song's beautiful. The lyrics are amazing. The message could be great. You don't understand the language. What should we do? HaKadosh Baruch Hu has his language, a godly language. If you're complaining, so the problem's with you, you don't understand it. So no, okay, go learn. Go sit. Learn for a lot of years. Learn God's language, and now you'll understand his language that he's talking to you in. But by God, his language is Kol man de'avid rachmana l'tav avid. Everything's good. There is no such thing as bad. And if that's the case, death is not bad, and hardship isn't bad, and struggle isn't bad, it's all good. Am Yisrael suffered in Egypt, there's no doubt about it. Did they pay a consequence in life? 80% of the Jewish nation was wiped out. 80%, more than World War II, more than all the other things that we have throughout history. Was it challenging? Yes. Did they complain? Yes. They sighed. They were in terrible, terrible... It wasn't 1 year, 2 years, 3 years, 210 years. It's a very, very long period of time. But did something good come out of it? Yeah, Hayom Hazeh Niyet Al-Am. We became a nation only because of that. There would be no Matan Torah and there would be no Jewish nation without that. Why did HaKadosh Baruch Hu have to do it that we should go to Egypt in order to come out to be Jews? I don't know. That, you want to know Cheshbonot Shemayim and everything. It happens to be here. Chazal do talk about it. But that will be a class for a different day. But, so in retrospect, Was it bad? It wasn't bad. There wouldn't be us. There would be no Am Yisrael without it. This was the Kula Hituch. This is what people had to go through in order to be able to obtain the spiritual levels that Am Yisrael obtained as a result of being, of doing what they did, of being what they did and paying the price that they did. Number two, this taught Am Yisrael discipline. Because Baruch Hu tells Am Yisrael when he takes them out of Egypt, you were slaves, now you're free, but I didn't take you out of there to be free the way the Goyim consider free. You went from Avdei Mitzrayim to Avdei Amakum, from servants of Paro to servants of God. And that probably, according to many Sfarim, was one of the reasons why it was done. Is so Am Yisrael should learn what it means to be a servant. One of the things that Rav Shlomo Shvadron used to talk about was what do Chazal say in the Midrash? You're going to talk about this probably by the Haggadah. That how did the Paro sucker the guys in to be to slaves for him? He didn't tell him, I want slaves. Nobody would show up. Everybody would run away. It would be a revolt. He told him he wants paid employees. And he's paying union salaries with benefits. Not only that, he gave them what's called incentive bonuses. He said, if you work nonstop, you don't take lunch breaks and this and that and all the other, I don't know how many breaks today, there are many other breaks already. They're called phone breaks. Most of the day I work, people are on their phones. If you do it like that, then I'll give you more money even. And the first day or period of time, the Jews went to work. The Jews like money. And he paid. It wasn't a scam. And he gave them the extra. So the next day they were even more motivated. And they kept log of exactly how much work every Jew did. And then they came to him and they told him, alright, so this is what you could do. Now you're a slave. You better stick to that amount because you prove you could do it. Don't say you can't. Comes up Shalom Shradon and says, if you want another way God deals with a person, a guy doesn't wake up in the morning to go pray. Tired. He has a reason. He's an onus, he's patur. But one morning he has a flight to the Bahamas at 6:30 in the morning. And at 4 he was up. At 4:30 he was already packed and showered and shaven. At 5 he was already in JFK. An hour and a half early. After 120 he comes to Shamayim and HaKadosh Baruch Hu tells him, did you wake up in the morning to pray? No. Why? It wasn't my type. I wasn't up to it. It wasn't on my level. And HaKadosh Baruch Hu is going to say, you're right. Straight to Gan Eden. It's not your fault. And then Bahamas Airlines is going to fly by the door of Gan Eden and there won't be an entrance. They say, you were able to get up when you wanted to. So the issue is what you wanted to do or what you didn't want to do. To read a novel for 6 hours straight, everybody has patience to do. But to read the Haggadah for 20 minutes, nobody has patience for. That don't work. That's a double standard. And we are against fraud. And the worst person to defraud is yourself. You defrauded somebody else, he got hurt, he may get you back, he may not, whatever it's going to be. Or at least he could write you off. When you defrauded yourself, what are you going to do, write yourself off? Then you're a total goner. Loser. There's none left to you at that point. Now, Pesach, we go on a very restrictive diet. No chametz. Ashkenaz people forget about it. They starve completely. Everything's automatic. No. You eat eggs, potatoes, and vegetable oil for 8, 9 days, whatever. It's an amazing thing. Probably stick a wick into any Ashkenaz food on Passover and it will be like the menorah with light for the whole Passover. I don't know if I'm exaggerating, by the way. And they have many, many chumrot, which I'm not mocking. God bless them. You know, this is what their customs are. I mean, Hagar Otam B'Adam, it's very beautiful if they stick to it. I have a friend, he has a custom, they don't eat anything with a peel on it. So if they want to use tomatoes, they buy tomatoes and then they peel the tomato. You ever try peeling a tomato? Don't try it. It's not fun. There's no end. It goes and goes and goes. I don't know where, but somewhere I discussed this in the past 2 weeks. There are many, many chassidim that don't eat anything that's processed. Anything that comes from a factory. We go to Seasons, we buy canned goods. They don't eat anything that's processed. So they don't even eat oil. Forget about kitniyot oil. Which, by the way, I want to publicly announce because a few guys sent me questions today. You cannot go buy OU oil that only kitniyot unless it has a Passover certification. I don't care what the lists say. The OU themselves told me there's chametz in these products. And a lot of people put out lists. And they write, yeah, for Sephardic Jews, as long as there's an OU, and you look in the ingredients, there's nothing except for kitniot, you could drink it, or you could eat it. It's not true. These people are putting out these lists of being machshil tarabim in the worst way. It doesn't work like that. It has to have a kosher for Passover certification. In America, other than OUP kitniot, which is very limited products, we don't have that. So you got to buy Israeli products if you want to have kitniot products for Passover. Because they have Adatz Beit Yosef, which is a good hechsher, with kitniot approval. But this is very rare. And this today I got many questions like that on many, many products. That something's organic, here's another one. Doesn't make it kosher for Passover. Just the opposite. If your shampoo is organic, then even though regular shampoo, you don't have to check and whatever's in it's okay. Organic soap and shampoo and perfume and cosmetics cannot be used on Passover. That's the only ones that have a problem for Sephardic Jews.
And no organic shampoo.
You can't use any organic shampoo unless it's 100% ingredient free of anything that can relate to chametz. A regular shampoo, even though some poskim say also has to have certain ingredients, can't be there. We say it's fine. Organic shampoo, you could eat. It actually has nutrition value in it. That's not a joke. That was lab tested.
Organic homemade wax. Dog can't eat it.
I don't know what those things are, so you have to tell me what they are.
Air products. That might have.
If it's not edible, then that. But organic, by definition in general, the reason why you're paying the premium for that product is because it's edible. It has no chemicals, no poisons. No, that's why you're paying that premium. If it's poison, then it doesn't have to be kosher for Pesach. But if it's poison, then it's not organic by definition because they don't. The whole idea behind their whole sales pitch to you is this has nothing toxic in it. This is perfect. So all our regular soaps and shampoos and this that we use everything because anybody's drinking a bottle of soap, no. But the organic stuff, many poskim come and say, wait a second. So here's a different issue. But kal vachomer 1,000 times over, and regular products. It's not, Pesach's not a joke, can't be taken lightly. Chametz is not batil, even 1 to 1,000 on Pesach. That's more than milk and meat. It's a lot more serious, a lot more stringent. And that's why the Ashkenaz Jewry, some of them, took Pesach to such an extreme. They went all out. So I have friends, they don't use oil, because oil's processed, made in a factory. So if they would make it at home, fine. But if not, they don't do it. But you do need fats to cook with, so how do you cook? How do you bake? So they use chicken fat. That fat layer of the chicken that's left over, so they melt that and that's what they use. But they want to have cakes and cookies on Pesach. So their brownies, you can't have with coffee or milk, because their brownies are meat that has chicken fat inside. Suddenly your menu's pretty good, right? We're not that off anymore. We got a pretty easy life for Pesach. But Hashem Yisrael, unbelievable. I don't say it to make fun. If this is what they're into, if this works for them, Hashem! Each community with their customs. All different communities have all different interesting customs when it comes to Passover. Why? Why Passover? So of course the simple understanding is because of the Chumrat HaInyan, how severe the sin is of eating chametz on Pesach. But I think there's something else that's going on here that's a lot deeper, and this is what I want to discuss a little. We should never know somebody's arrested and they're coming to put on handcuffs. And the agent that's going to put on his handcuffs happens to be a nice guy. And he says, not that he's a criminal, it's true, but he's still a person. So he tells him, listen, I got 10 pairs of handcuffs, all different sizes, shapes, all different materials made out of. Pick which one you want to wear. Because you're going to be wearing these for the next 24 hours. Because we got to transport you and everything else. Out of the 10 pairs that he's going to pick, which one is he going to pick? The ones that are the thinnest and the lightest. Because his weight on his hand, that restricts him. The lighter, the better. We take a girl to a jewelry store. Shah Tova, it's your 25th anniversary, and you want to buy your wife some sort of piece of jewelry. Let's say a bracelet. And they show her 10 bracelets. Each one at a different weight of diamonds inside. Which one do you want to pick? The heaviest one. What's the question, right? If you don't pick the heaviest one, go get yourself checked out. Something's wrong. What's the difference? Because what you want to wear is not heavy. What you don't want to wear suddenly is heavy. Handcuffs nobody wants to wear, so we picked the lightest one. A nice diamond bracelet everybody wants to wear. So the heavier the better, bring it on. Why not? If you want Pesach, then your diet's not restrictive. It's actually good. When you went to some dietitian and paid who knows how much money each appointment for weeks upon weeks, and she pretty much told you you can't eat anything except for lettuce, and you became like some sort of animal that only eats certain greens, that you did no problem. Do you complain about it? No. Why? That was weight. What do you mean? This is what they told me to do. When they started telling you to drink all these healthy shakes that you can't even swallow them, I don't know if you make a blessing on some of these things, because they taste so disgusting. You did it. Why? Because somebody convinced you it's good for you, it's going to make you healthy. There's nobody in here that's going to tell me that wheatgrass tastes good, right? I would hope not, at least. They mix it with all different things, but is it healthy? Yeah, there's a lot of research today that backs it. There's no doubt about it. So what's the answer? What you want works. What you don't want doesn't work. It's that simple. So now we got to figure out a way, and this is really what would be our greatest accomplishment that we could possibly do together tonight. How do you want Pesach? And if you want Pesach, then all the problems that come along the way fall aside. They're all trivial details in comparison to what you want. So let's try and go on a little journey in. On Shabbat HaGadol, we read an interesting haftarah. We're going to quote a few little pieces of within the haftarah, the psukim, and try to build something together over here. Chazal teach us that in every generation, we spoke about this last week, how it applies to halakha, a person has to show as if he went out of Egypt. Shabbat HaGadol was the beginning of that process. The way Shabbat HaGadol came out in Egypt, it was Yud Nisan, and that was the day that they really broke free of the Avodah Zarah of Egypt. They took the Egyptian idol and tied it to their bed. It was called a sheet. They did multiple things at once by accomplishing that. Number one, they were Moshech Mishchu Kulachem, it says in the Pasuk. They were Moshech Yideim Avodah Zarah. They stopped their interaction with idol worship. Number two, they were kru, they took for themselves a great mitzvah. Number three, they prepared themselves to go out of Egypt and to be ready for the ultimate goal, Matan Torah. But besides for all this, there was another thing. We spoke about this in our last year, before Pesach last year. I got to compliment all of you tonight. This is amazing, by the way. I'm going to admit, and I'm going to ask you forgiveness and publicly and bless you, because I was choshed b'ksherim. This morning, my wife asked me, is there shiur tonight? And I told her yes. And she said, why? I said, I'll tell you the truth. I have a feeling I won't have a minyan, 10 people. But I listened to somebody who runs the show for me, Chaim, and he told me there's a shiur. And if he said there's a shiur, I automatically say yes. I just told her that I hope I'm not going to be in a test at the end of the night to kill Chaim for bringing me out from Lakewood 2.5 hours there, 2.5 hours back. Eid of Pesach for 4 people. Ashrechem Yisrael. First of all, I apologize for thinking that you guys are too busy to show up to Torah. Second of all, tonight most shiurim in the world are canceled. And the Ben Yishchai and the Chida were both mechaven to the same thing. And they say that when you learn Torah at a time that others don't learn Torah, you notel sachar keneged kulam. So shiur tonight is like hundreds of shiurim that otherwise you would have learned. It's an unbelievable thing. This is a big, big sechut to take into Pesach tonight. This is the big leagues. And because the Choshed B'Ksherim owes the people a blessing, I bless you all that this year your Passover should be happy.
Amen.
And if you have a happy Passover, your life will be happy already. That I guarantee you. But what's going on over here? So there's another thing that's going on. What's the culture of a slave? That even if he's freed one day, he still stays in the same mentality. Let me give you many examples. The statistics show, I don't know the exact numbers in each state, so I won't quote, I'm going to just give you rough estimates, that somewhere between 17% on the low end and 38% on the higher end of prisoners that come out of jail after long sentences are back in jail. I think it's in under a 90-day period of time. If I'm wrong on that, it's under a 180-day period. If anything, these are the last people that should ever be back in prison. They were just there. They should be as careful as could be. The answer is when you have a criminal's mentality and you were surrounded by criminals for so many years, you are a criminal. And it takes a lot of help and therapy and rehab to help give you a chance to be somebody normal one day. And most of these people aren't given those tools. And as a result, they land right back. Many of us had associations with goyim as employees on one level or the other through charity programs, goyim's charity programs that help prisoners try to lead a normal life. And sometimes we would talk to these workers, laborers that were working for us, and they would tell us, I was in prison 6 times already, 8 times already. I tell a guy, dude, you got caught once, what'd you think? You won't get caught 7 more times afterwards? I'm like, nuts. But crime is a revolving cycle because of a culture. Addicts. La'aleinu v'la'alechem, widespread problem. They're addicts in all fields. We're all addicts, called iPhone addicts. Try to rehabilitate yourself from your phone. Halevai, it lasts for a few hours. In shul, before Kippur, we're able to convince Aseret Yemei Tshuva people to shut off their phone for 15 minutes mincha. 10 days a year. If that's not an addict, then what's left? Now you want to rehabilitate yourself from the addiction. Let's say you succeed against all odds. The odds of falling back into it are so great. I have an acquaintance who I consider a very dear friend. And to a certain extent, I consider him a role model. He was a boy who successfully almost destroyed his life at the age of 17. He was a severe alcoholic. There was a point in his life that in an average 24-hour period, he would consume over 1.1 liters of hard liquor. How he's alive today and still has a liver, I don't know. He was 17 years old, attended a class that I gave in South Beach in Florida. And he didn't come to hear a class. That wasn't what he was interested in. He came because it was in a hotel, and there was an open bar, and it was free high-end booze. And this was the perfect place then. I saw a boy who looked underage, drinking, not 1 glass, 2 glasses, 3 glasses. I normally don't mind people's business, but over here I felt it wasn't safe. And I sent a message to the bartender to ID him. Of course it didn't work, and he was flagged, he couldn't drink anymore. He was very upset. He asked the bartender, who told you to ask me for ID? Instead of the bartender understanding that, stay quiet, he pointed to me. So this drunk comes over to me enraged. And I can't lift a 5-10 bag of sugar. So definitely I don't know how to fight. I wasn't really ready for this. He starts yelling at me, says a lot of words that can't be said, and were repeated, and he goes on and on. But I saw an interesting thing after about 3 minutes of him yelling. That if he would have wanted to throw a punch, it was no big deal. He was drunk, he could have done it. And he didn't do it. And nobody was trying to stop him either. It looked like everybody was intimidated from this kid. I said, if he's so angry, and he's drunk, and he's not getting physical, it must be that deep down there's somebody very good inside. But la'aleinu, he got caught up in this sickness called alcohol. So I asked him, where's he sleeping tonight? He said, I have no idea. So what do you mean you have no idea? He said, his parents live in New York at all. He took, some bus, I think. He told me he took 20-something hours to get to South Florida. He took a bus a few weeks before. And he's like a beach bum, and he gets here and there, hustles jobs, or steals liquor. I don't know what he does with himself. Jewish kid from a good family. I hear all of this, and I tell him, listen, can I call your parents? And he's like half tipsy, half, no, I don't know. Just do whatever you want. What do you want to call my parents for? I hate them, I this. I said, I just want to ask them if they can sign a legal document for me that says that I can put you tonight into rehab. He said, why would I go there? I said, well, first of all, for nothing else, you'll have a clean bed, fresh linen, a clean shower, a change of clothes, 3 free meals a day, glatt kosher. You know, there are a lot of benefits. Second of all, if you ever want to stand a chance to have a normal life, this is it. This is your one shot at it. Nobody else is going to do this for you. So he tells me, but what if I don't like that? I said, what's the big deal? To go back to being a drunk, you could do at any age. To have a chance to lead a normal life, you can only do at a young age. So give it a shot. You don't like it, go back. Round 2. He said, you know what, call my parents. He gives me a number, I pick up. It's really his parents. I tell him, listen, I found your son, he's a minor. I can't deal with them by law. You're obligated. There is a rehab center. This is the name. This is what it costs. If you can afford it, fine. If not, we'll pay for it. We want to put your son there. We want to have somebody drive him from here to there directly and have him there ready tonight. But it's contingent on you, number one, filling out applications there and doing what you got to do for them to, for it to be legal for them to take him. And contingent on you sending a notarized letter, faxed right away to this hotel that we're in, saying that one of us can later on drive your son to this place. Because we have to do things the legal, proper way. They were the happiest people in the world. They said, you're the first, our son is really willing to go? Yeah. So we've been begging him since he's 16. I said, I don't know, he's willing to go. Let's do it. We put this kid in rehab, make a long story short, 90 days later he was already out. From there he went to Israel in yeshiva, started doing extremely well. 5.5 years he stayed in Israel learning Torah. Wow. He went from being a drunk to a huge Talmid Chacham. Wow. But not just learning. He went to Israel with such a passion, he wanted to make up for all his lost years. From 12 to 17, 18, he didn't do anything productive in his life. So he learned way more than anybody else. To the point that Shiva used to call me constantly to speak to him, to tame down. He was scared it was too much, it's dangerous. Came back to the United States. So 5.5 years, he comes back to the U.S. He came back during for a couple of times to Passover with his parents, but I never got to see him. He came back and he was going to stay here already. And I was so excited to see this tzaddik. We were in touch a lot on the phone and that, and I saw him in Israel a few times. But I, you know, came back to welcome him back. That I did something that is very out of character for me for a lot of reasons. Amongst the many reasons, time constraints. I went to JFK to the airport to pick him up. His parents went, I went, and a few other friends went. And we're waiting there in JFK for him to come. He was coming in on an afternoon flight. And he walks out. Mother, father, everybody's so excited to see him. And his father is a very generous, successful person. And he says, you're probably starving. Because El Al, no matter what class you're flying in, the food is not always, you know, Michelin star chefs. I'm not saying bad, God forbid, relative to some of the other ones. It's good, actually. But it's not, you know. Let's go to a good restaurant. And we went to some expensive restaurant in Manhattan. I like having a shot once in a while. This, to me, was a reason to celebrate. I wasn't so paying attention. This kid, Chazi, was an alcoholic a few years ago or whatever. His father also likes having a drink or two. We got a few shots brought to the table, and they were in the middle of the table. And as soon as they put them down, the kid got up and walked away. Now, nobody realized why. None of us put this together. A couple of minutes later, he wasn't coming back, and I see him standing. It's not like he left. He's standing in a corner. So I went to him. I said, everything okay? He says, yeah, guys, but finish what you're doing, and I'll come back. I said, what do you mean what I'm doing? What are we doing? We're doing this for you. We came to have dinner with you. You just came back from Israel. He said, no, but there's alcohol on the table. He said, all I need is to smell it once and I'll be right back to where I started. I said, that's it. This is goodbye. He says, and one of the problems I'm going to have getting married is I'm going to have to explain to my wife that in our house there'll never be kiddush on alcohol. And he says, and you want to know how far it goes? I don't even think kiddush on grape juice because I don't want to have something similar to that taste. I do kiddush on challah. On Shabbat day, I hear it from somebody else. Because it'll bring me right back to it. Meaning a person, what he's used to and acquainted with, is his natural habit to go right back to. You know what the greatest miracle of leaving Egypt was? That a nation that was slaves for so many years were able, in one commandment of God, to take their owners, their master's idol, and tie it to a bedpost in the most degrading way in front of their owner's eyes, all in a matter of days. To break free of the culture of slavery so quickly is the greatest miracle of all. That is the biggest Yitziat Mitzrayim. You want to know what the whole story of the Seder really is behind everything that goes on? There's a weird halacha when it comes to Pesach. Matchil begnut u'mesayem b'shvach. In order to do the mitzvah sipu Yitziat Mitzrayim, you have to begin with the bad. Mitchila uvdei avodah zara yu avoteinu, we say in the Agadah. Our forefathers were idol worshippers and so on. U'mesayem b'shvach, and end off with the good. Why would you do that? Imagine somebody got up by a sheva b'rachot, and he wants to be mekayem the mitzvah of being meshabeach the kala before the chatan, as the Gemara says. Tanaim and Amoraim went to very great lengths for this mitzvah. And he gets up there and he says, this girl is an amazing girl. She's a self-made woman. But instead of talking about how self-made she is, he talks about why she had to be self-made. And goes through, she used to be a heroin addict, and there's a, look who she is today. Would any bride want to be there at that point? She'd rather die than hearing the speech. Here we're celebrating freedom. We're celebrating where we came, you know, that we're not where we came from. We're celebrating a more positive situation in life today. We're celebrating being Avdei Hashem. We're celebrating all these beautiful things. And what did Chazal tell us? Matchil begnut. Go talk about all the bad. For what? There's thousands of commentaries, literally, to talk about this. I want to tell you just my little feeling. You know why God wants to do it? He wants to come to a person and show him on the night of Pesach by the Seder. You can bake free from everything right now. Just decide to do so. I tell the Jews to break free from 210 years of slavery, and that was an indicator for generations forever that a mentality or a habit or anything else can be broken and doesn't have to take years or months or lifetimes or whatever else they convince you in school. It can be done instantly. Cold turkey, we call it. But a person has to have the willpower and the belief in himself that he wants to change and that he wants his culture to change and he wants to be a different person. And at that point, the sky's the limit. There's nothing you can't do. Here's what it says in Chazal. And HaKadosh Baruch Hu went and showed it to him. He said, look what you were able to do. You were able to go from slavery to total freedom instantly. We sit by the Haggadah and we don't only say, wow, we're great, we're free. Because from that, there's no message. Okay, so we're free. Congrats. We were born and raised in a democracy. All we know is freedom. We sit and say, no, naturally, we're everything but free people. Naturally, our mentality, our culture, we were slaves and not even in a respectable profession. We were cement workers. And look what we became from cement workers. From unpaid cement workers. That means that it makes no difference where you're at now. It's a matter of where you decide you want to be. And that's why it's called Leil HaSedeh. Sedeh means to organize. Laila shemisadrim bo dvarim harbe. It's the night that you organize your entire life. And you organize it by making this decision to take that leap to the next step. I want to tell you something that I find extremely painful and tragic. I spend many, many hours of my life talking to people that are struggling emotionally on one end or the other, in one area or the other. And we all struggle emotionally at one point in our lives. Many of us for many, many years, and it's not an easy struggle at all. And many times, it's because of lack of knowledge, lack of tools, lack of support, or other things, which are all justified reasons for these struggles. But sometimes we take a person who's struggling greatly emotionally, and we help them out, and we give them all the tools to success, and we hold them hand through it, step by step, and they're there. They're at the point that they should be happy, healthy, and successful. And exactly at that point, they fail in the biggest way. In the medical world, tries to blame it on relapsing, they call it, or other things like it. I want to tell you a theory, which is not my own, it's a medical theory, but to me there's a medical reality. Somebody who suffered for many years, somebody who grew up in an abusive home, somebody who had parents who are controlling, somebody who grew up in poverty, somebody who suffered from depression, was suicidal, God forbid, or whatever it is, each one with his story. And now got to a point where they actually feel good. Their comfort zone for a long period of time was misery. Now they're out of their comfort zone. And when they're out of their comfort zone, to them that's a greater problem than the problem they were suffering from before. So it's not that they relapsed. It's a new problem came about that gave them a new reason to fall very deep. I'll give you a very practical example. In a few weeks, it's going to be Lag BaOmer. I know for many, many years, every single year, B'nisei Nisim, I go to Israel, take a lot of boys, we go, do good things there. Shum Bayochai, Lag BaOmer, unreal. One year, I told one boy that I wanted to come. I was 25 years old. He told me I was never on an airplane in my life. I said, 25 years old, never on an airplane? He said, yeah. I said, I thought maybe he comes from a family that can't afford such things. He's in school. He's in debt over his head. So I told him, if the issue is the ticket, I have a sponsor. Don't worry. It's on me. Come. So I said, are you crazy? My father's rich. You think that's the problem? My father would pay me to go on an airplane. I said, so why don't you go on an airplane? He said, because I'm scared. I have a fear of flying. Other than the dentist, that's the second to most common fear in the United States of America. That's not a joke, by the way, it's serious. Second to most common fear in the United States of America is the fear of flying. I told him, I agree with you. But guess what? You'll fly with me. And I have a calming effect on people. So you'll be scared, I'll calm you down, everything will be fine, and we'll have a great flight together to Israel. He called his father to tell him that he's considering going to Israel, Yaakov, for Lag BaOmer. His father called me on my cell phone that night maybe 40 times in a row. I didn't know his number, I didn't pick up. Finally I picked up, I said, I called so many times in a row, it must be Pikuach Nefesh. He says, Yaakov, listen to me and listen to me good. My kid's in school, he's graduating soon, he's gonna go out to the business world, he's a handicap, he doesn't fly. Today the world, you have to be able to go everywhere. Who's gonna marry him like this? He's a perfect kid, except for he's restricted. I don't care what it takes. Here's a credit card number. There's an unlimited credit limit. You make sure that this kid is on a plane with you to Israel. And if the risk is that he'll be too scared to fly back, I don't care about that either. Let him live there for the rest of his life. I tell them, sir, but you know, this is a liability. He says, what do you want, a waiver from a lawyer? Tomorrow I give that to you. What else do you want? I said, no, it's not my liability. It's your liability as a father. We're taking a kid, we're putting him in a very uncomfortable situation. He says, you want me to sweeten the deal for you? What do you want? The whole trip's on me. Just take him. I said, oh, we're going down that road? I have more things I need too. Guy heard, he was into it. Make a long story short, I take the kid on the plane. What did I do? I called him and I said, listen, yesterday I spoke to you about Lag BaOmer. Unfortunately, something came up personal, and for the first year, many years, I can't go. So, I don't know if I convinced you into something and now you're that. But if I'm not going, and you said you're scared to fly, so let's forget about it. In the meantime, I had already bought two tickets. But I figured, what does he have to be nervous for 3 weeks before? Well, what am I going to gain from that? We had a flight 1:30 p.m. on a Sunday from Newark. 9 o'clock a.m. I showed up in his house in Flatbush. He said, what are you doing here? I said, we got a flight soon. And he said, what do you mean? I said, are you crazy? Rav Shimon Bar Yochai is waiting and we're not going to show up? Are you crazy? What's wrong with you? He says, but. I said, no buts. He said, clothes, packing, this, that. I said, don't worry, your mom was in on this. She took care of everything for you. You're a 25-year-old baby. You have a packed suitcase. You even have notes, what clothes, what to wear, what to do. You got it all down to a science. Driver with a beautiful car outside, we're going. He's in the car on the way to the airport, like an hour later, took him an hour to get ready. I felt bad for him. Honestly, my heart was going out. He was sweaty. He was uncomfortable. He was squeezing one of my wrists so hard, I had marks the days afterwards. It was out of control. He says, I don't even drive by airports. That's what he tells me, I don't even drive by airports. I said, well, guess what? Now we're going to one. Make a long story short, in the airport, Baruch Hashem, thank you, Elal. There was great wine in the lounge. We poured a few glasses of wine, and his nerves were a little calmer at that point. And we went on the plane, he fell asleep right away, so that was a good thing. He woke up about 2 hours before the end of the flight. Honestly, I did not sleep that flight, even though I love sleeping the entire flight, because I was keeping an eye on this guy's pulse, pretty much. Yeah, I was on the job. Make sure he gets there safely. And when he wakes up, he gets up, goes to the restroom, gets dressed, back dressed, and he asks for breakfast, and he's sitting and eating breakfast on a plane. And he looks so fine. He's not worried. He's not holding my hand anymore. Everything's beautiful. Life is great. Joking around with me. Maybe 5 minutes before landing, he went back to the sweating and this and that. So I turned to him and I said, look, buddy, now already I don't trust you anymore. Before the flight, you never did it before. You were scared. We're all scared of the unknown. On the flight, you slept like a baby. 7 hours I watched you sleep. So you couldn't be too scared. Let's be real. I don't know what sleeping pill you did take, didn't take. If you were that scared, nothing would work. So it wasn't as bad as you made it sound. Then you ate breakfast, you didn't puke your food, you didn't gag on it, you asked for more, you had a really good time. We were joking around. Now, 5 minutes before landing, suddenly now it's a problem. He looks at me and he says, Yaakov, I'm embarrassed to say this, but I'm scared. Why I'm not scared? He's not scared anymore. So he's scared. Why he's not scared? I said, like this, you're going to ruin your whole life forever. I said, because imagine one day you're in a bad mood. And that bad mood lasts for more than a day, Lalena. A week, a month, 6 months. And then, thank God, you feel better. At that point, you're going to be in a bad mood. Why are you not in a bad mood? Because when a person gets into a comfort zone, he's stuck there. And when you take him out of the comfort zone, even if his comfort zone was the worst things in the world, he doesn't know how to handle it. And Pesach is a holiday. The whole message of the Haggadah is, just because this was yesterday, that doesn't mean you have to be that way today. And don't think that the place that you're in is where you have to be stuck. HaKadosh Baruch Hu gives a special power on the eve of Pesach by the Seder. Laila shemesadrim bo dvarim harbe. It's a night that they will organize your life in the greatest way. And that's, first and foremost, in emotional health. Without emotional health, what's life worth? Physical health, finance, relationships, and everything else. Dvarim harbe. There's no end. It's not one thing. Sometimes there's a certain holiday that has a power for a specific thing. Pesach, misadrim bo dvarim harbe, everything. That's what Kosh Boku says. I end off with a thought. I said this thought in Bayswater on Wednesday, 10 days ago. So those of you who heard the recording, forgive me for repeating. But in case many of you didn't, I would like to say it over once again. Here's a Rashi. Rashi is extremely grounded to Pshat. Rashi is called a Mefaresh HaMikra. He writes the Pshat, the simple understanding of the thing. And Rashi is written in great depth, obviously. But his goal was to explain us the Torah. The Pasuk teaches us Hashir Yelachem Kileil Hitkadesh Chag, which B'Pashtut is talking about the song Halel Kileil Hitkadesh Chag on Yom Tov. We say Halel. Normally when we say Halel on Yom Tov, it's in the morning. When it comes to Pesach, we add on more Halel. By Arbit, when we go to Shul, Arbit, first night of Pesach, we say Halel. Then we come home again, by the Seder, again Halel. That Halel we split into two. An initial segment at the beginning of the Seder, and then at the end of the Seder, the majority of the Halel. So I want to teach you two things over here. Rashi says, Hashir Yelachem. You want to know how you are going to look when Mashiach comes? Are you going to be close to him? Are you going to be happy to see him? Are you going to be embarrassed and run away? Are you going to be there at all? You want to know what's going to be with you when Mashiach comes? Kileil Hitkadesh Chag. Pay attention to the way your Halel looks on the night of the Seder. The same way you felt and you said Halel the night of the Seder, that's the way you're going to be when Mashiach comes. If you went to sleep already, so you'll sleep through Mashiach, that would be a shame. If you were frustrated and annoyed and yelled at everybody, come on, can we get this over with already? So Mashiach's going to see you, he's going to wave quickly and say, I want to get it over with already. But if you were happy and you felt calm and content and awake, then you'll be from the first to be mekabel pnei Mashiach. This I talk both to the women in the room. Women work extremely hard before Passover. Guys talk a lot before Passover about everything they're doing. In reality, they do nothing. And the women actually work hard before Passover. That's the way it is in most houses. The guys talk, the women do. Then the husband has the chutzpah to come with demands afterwards. What'd you do? What'd you contribute to this holiday? One guy told me, I stay out of my wife's way. I said, I have a great idea. Stay out of her way for the night of the Seder too. Don't show up at all. What does he stay out of it? He didn't partake in preparing for Pesach. What's going on over here? I pay the bills. Pay the bills. I said, I have a charity fund that paid 6,000 families food bills for Pesach this year. We don't need you to pay our bills. It's fine. What is it? I don't understand that whole concept. But this work comes with a heavy price. And that heavy price is that normally, by the Seder, most Jewish women are zanked. And that's atzat hayetzara. Your house will run just fine and your meal will be just perfect with five less dishes and with other things less and with you taking a nap at a Pesach for a few hours. So you could be awake by the Seder. And you could actually feel awake by the Seder. For many years, I said something that I was getting killed for. But now I found the source, finally. So if you want to take it up, you're going to have to take it up with the Chazonish and the Stipler. In Halacha, it's brought down, it's ready in the Gemara, discusses it. And the night of the Seder, you got to make a beautiful table. And they used to take, even borrow silver utensils to make the table look nicer. And all these beautiful things. And this is really the ultimate way to do it, if you have a maid that's going to do the dishes afterwards. I promoted doing otherwise in many Jewish homes, especially homes with a lot of little kids. Even though, lichora, it's arrogant to even say such a thing. It's against halacha. It doesn't add up. It's not, what are you doing? How can you say such a thing? So I want to tell you an amazing thing. There's a sefer called Divrei Siach from Chaim Kanievsky. Hashem should give him a long life. Amen. Set over a story from his father, the Stiplers itself. Zechutei Yagen Aleinu. That a boy went into the Stipler. The boy belonged to the Lithuanian communities, Litvish. The Litvish boys on Shabbat wear ties. Yeshiva students during the week, they don't. Then on Shabbat, they wear ties. The truth is, in New York, to wear a tie is not that big of a deal. Most of the year, it's cold anyway. And the humidity in general is very low. And for the 2 months a year that it's not like that, well, not the end of the world. And it's in our culture. Many people, businessmen wear ties all week. And, you know, it's part. It's something that we're very acquainted with. Israelis, I don't know if you have Israeli family or not, but many chatanim walk down to the chuppah without a tie. Or a bow tie or anything. It's normal. You can make the fanciest wedding, spend fortunes of money, and the guy comes with an untucked shirt without even a blazer. And that's perfectly normal. That is their culture. Because to them, comfort means more than everything else. Look at all the Israeli stars and artists and whatever. None of them dress well. Shem Yerachem, you know. I always wondered, there's no fashion consultants in Israel? The answer is, there's comfort consultants. To them, they explained it to me. They prioritize comfort over everything. I don't know if this is true or not true, but somebody once told me, I don't know if he meant it seriously as a joke, a judge in Israel, that the reason why in Israel they have this law of that lawyers have to come into court wearing a cloak. In America, we don't have that, right? A lawyer comes into court, he dresses respectable, but that's it. In Israel, there's a dress code. You have to wear some costume on top of your clothes, and that's the way you come to court. He told me the reason why they do it is just because in the U.S., every lawyer understands that at least the court come dressed normally. He said they even advise their clients, the criminals, to come dressed normally. He says in Israel, if we wouldn't have something that they have to cover their clothes with, they would come with System of the Doubt t-shirts, flip-flops, and shorts. And there is a concept of respecting the courthouse. So therefore, we got to make such a law. I don't know if there's any truth to that or not, but... So this boy belongs to a Litvish yeshiva that's in Bnei Brak. Bnei Brak is warm most of the year, and the humidity levels are unbearable, especially June, July, August, September, unbearable. You walk 10 feet on the street, it's unbearable. And he didn't wear a tie on Shabbat because of that. It made him can't. He needed the air. One day, so Shiva came to him and said, "Kvod Shabbat! You have to respect Shabbat." So he said he's gonna ask for a psak halacha. So Shiva told him, "No problem, go to the stipler. Whatever the stipler tells you, that's what you should do." Why does Shiva send him to the stipler? Because the stipler didn't wear a tie, I think. If he sends it to a rabbi, he wears a tie, so he could later on say the guy was biased. But if it's a rabbi who doesn't wear a tie, right? So the stipler, when he came to him, smiled and told him, "You know, I just had a similar question. And really, this question already somebody asked the Chazonish before me. And that's how I know what to answer." So he said, "What was the similar question?" He said, "A Kollel student just came in to me and asked me a question like this. His wife has B'li Ayin Hara, a few little ones at home, close together. And it's hard for her. Friday night, she sets the table. She sets the table with china and silverware and glass cups and everything. The husband feels bad for his wife. She has a bunch of little babies. She's busy all week. She doesn't sleep well at night. Even Friday night, she doesn't sleep through the night. He doesn't want her to have to do dishes afterwards. And in Bnei Brak, most people can't afford maids. So he goes and buys fancy paper goods and tells her to use the paper goods. The woman says, 'Kvod Shabbat, it's not respect paper goods.' The man says, and by the Bukhari, well, it's the other way around. The woman wants to use the paper because the man says, 'No way.' But if you were raised it by Torah, then the husband cares about his wife, so he wants his wife to have as little work as possible, and as a result, he makes sure to eliminate any possible work that she has. So he says, what do we do? Who's right? And the wife told the husband, she's not going to agree to change to plastic wear on Shabbat unless the stipler himself says that it's the right thing to do.
Wild, no?
And this husband goes to the stipler. I'd be embarrassed to go to the stipler to ask him such a thing. He went to the stipler because by him there was no chochmah, there's a sheilat rav, and whatever he says, we're going to do. And the stipler told him he wants to tell him a psak halacha based on the Chazon Ish. Let's take a survey. What do you think the psak halacha was? Who was right? Paper goods or China for Friday night? Listen to who was right. Tie or no tie? The stipler told him that a boy came to the Chazon Ish and complained that in Bnei Brak it's hot, and he said when he wears a tie on Shabbat he sweats because of it and he suffers. It's not comfortable for him. He wants to know, should he suffer through it out of respect for Shabbat to wear a tie, or can he not wear a tie and leave another button open and feel better on Shabbat as a result? And the Chazon Ish told him that there is no such thing as Kvod Shabbat if it's not an onig for you. That means there is no such thing by definition as respect if it's not pleasure. And therefore, if the tie makes you feel disgusting and sweat, that's not Kvod Shabbat anymore. So the stipler told this guy, if that's the case, your wife's dead wrong. Of course she's right, Kvod Shabbat. But Kvod Shabbat at the expense of her sleep, at the expense of her health, at the expense of her sanity, at the expense of her patience with the kids, at the expense of her patience with you, what Kavod is there in that? Nothing. So when we'll be on the level of people that have a huge oneg in it, that outweighs everything else, halavai. But until then, yeah, sometimes on Pesach we have to cut some corners and do things a little bit easier and a little more practical. And the reason why we got to do that is because we don't want it to be so kosher without simcha. Because there's a mitzvah of simcha on Pesach. And if you went through the seder and you weren't happy, you defeated the whole purpose. Instead of Laila Shemis Sadrim Bo Dvarim Arbe, you confused it all. You made it all backwards. Unbelievable psak on the stipler on the Chazon Ish. By the way, based on that, a lot of guys that I used to, you know, sometimes comment to, that maybe when you come to shul in the summer, there are better ways to come than in a short sleeve t-shirt. I still stick to that theory. But in reality, if somebody does it, I wouldn't say anything anymore. Because maybe by him, this is his onig, and at that point, the Kvod Shabbat doesn't outweigh it. That's the Chazon Ish. Good luck. Kodesh Kevin, Bnei Brak, talk to him, say, I don't agree with you. I don't think it's a smart idea, because he may not agree with you afterwards, and yeah. I wouldn't mess with the Chazon Ish. But, yes.
In the beginning of the shiur, you said that 80% of Jews didn't want to leave. Well, why is that if they were slaves?
They got used to it. They were comfortable there.
But as a slave?
People get used to their situation. Right? There's a famous Jewish joke that a woman was in an abusive marriage. Her husband died one day, suddenly. And she was crying by the funeral. Everybody thought she'd be the happiest lady. She's done with him, finally. Shah Tova. So they asked her, why are you crying? So she said, who's going to hit me now? That's the tragedy of getting used to bad situations in life. If there had to be such a Jewish tale, Hashem Yirach, and what that means. Same idea in Pesach. They got used to Egypt. They didn't want to leave. People don't like changes. The whole idea of Pesach is to make changes. That's the whole idea. Change what you eat. Change what you do. Change your behavior patterns. Change your style of meals. Change your time. Change your learning schedule. Change everything about Pesach's changed. We turn your life upside down for 8 days. I also want to tell you something else, that you do your own homework. For those of you who don't smoke, I'm only talking about cigarettes. Other things, you know how to smoke, period. But for those of you who don't smoke cigarettes, don't start. But for those of us who do smoke cigarettes, you have to find a reliable source, the rabbinic source, that will tell you that they went to the tobacco factory and checked out all the 160 somewhat chemicals that are put into a cigarette and know that each and every one is kosher for Pesach. Otherwise, you are not allowed to smoke on Pesach. Yeah. And it's not a bad idea to take a 9-day break for your lungs. It's actually pretty good. I know from experience. That's by another thing people don't think about. Are you going to tell me I saw Hasidic Jews smoking and I saw this one smoking out? Yeah. Maybe they don't know. Maybe nobody told them. Maybe they didn't think about it. You see, in Israel, they have a company that makes cigarettes with hechshir for Pesach. There must be a reason why it has to be done. When I reversed engineered a Marlboro cigarette in the lab, it came out with a lot of interesting things, and many of them would qualify as chametz on Pesach. But I'm not eating it.
I'm only breathing it. If you're only breathing it and you're not eating it, then how are you allowed to smoke on Yom Tov? It's not Olchel Nefesh for you. So make up your mind. Where do you stand in which camp? So you should think about that. Number two, somebody spread a rumor that vapes are okay on Pesach because it's not food. Whoever spread that rumor is an Amaharetz Midoraita Midorabanan together. And he didn't bring any credible proof or anything. Just the opposite. There's a long tshuva from Moshe Weiss, and there are many other tshuvot from many other poskim. The vapes are made 100% for the flavor. That's the whole reason, right? That's the whole business. Different flavors and different tastes. And therefore, your liquid, your juice, as they call it, in the vape, has to be kosher for Passover. Yeah, has, or at least have credible evidence that there's no chametz in it. No real chametz in it. Yeah, save yourself from a sin on Passover. It won't hurt. I normally don't mention names of companies, but I think there's only one company that makes actual certified flavors kosher for Passover called Drop Smoke. So Drop Smoke, you owe me a thank you one day, I just gave you a plug. But if you want to do it, Google them and you can buy from them the kosher for Passover. Or, what are we talking about? You're talking about Erev Pesach from Zman Achilat Chametz, and only 2 days Chol HaMoed, it's Shabbat in the middle, there's no smoking most of the time. Yom Tov, it's a big bidiyavad to smoke either way. Vapes you can't use anyway, Yom Tov. So we're talking about maybe a 24-hour period, or 48-hour period, big deal. Control yourself, change a little bit. Imagine you went to, that would be your Korban Pesach. That's a good way to sell it. Today we don't got a Bet Mikdash. We can't bring a Korban Pesach. Your Korban Pesach is give up on your cigarettes and your vapes for 8 days. Give up. That's your Korban, that's your sacrifice of Pesach. You know that doesn't Shemayim, you know like when he sees a boy willing to take an addiction and throw it away? And then after the 8 days, you may not go back also. Won't hurt. But that's, by the way. Last but not least, I give you a trick. Take this trick with you. I quoted it already. I'm quoting it again for those who weren't here. When you say the Halil, at the end of the Seder, in the Halil, there's one little quote that's in the Kilo Olam Chasdo. It's already past the Halil part, technically. But it's called all Halil. You remember that from the prayers that we say in Shabbat and other times? From Tehillim? I heard 3 years ago on Erev Pesach from a rabbi in Israel named Rav Sender Erlanger, who told me in the name of the stipler, that the stipler told it to him in the name of a great Kabbalist called the Lashem Shvov Achlama, that if somebody, when he says that pasuk, by the Halil, after the Seder, has in mind all the miracles he needs in life and all the things he needs to change to the good in his life, it goes straight up, there's no angel that could stop him. So I gave you a good trick and a reason to stay awake for Halil. But don't have a double standard. Only one pasuk you said and the rest you fell asleep through, that won't work. So say Halil the right way and then, hey, you got a good piece of ammunition. That means, let's translate so we understand what we're saying. To the God who does great miracles by himself alone. What does that mean? That normally, you want something, Hashem has to give, you know, there's a court system upstairs. Shemayim have to approve. Leila said, Adi velo malach, comes God and says, it's me, one man show. I'll do it myself. Kilo lam chazdo, and it all comes through chesed, not through din, not through judgment. HaKadosh Baruch Hu should help, we should all have niflaot kidolot bezat Hashem. Lechag Pesach kasher v'sameach. What do you want to know about rice? You gotta check rice 3 times, as not as a halacha, as a custom. That's what we do.
3 times.